Philips is an independent consultant and contractor based in Belgium. He provides research and development on low-level software and operating systems, particularly in an embedded or real-time context. His main interests are bootloaders, device drivers, and high-performance networking. He can be convinced to teach courses, workshops, variety of networking-related topics in his free time. So Philip is a FreeBSD committer, contributing mainly to the kernel and a member of the FreeBSD security team. He was one of the main organizers of FOSSASIA, the largest annual open source software conference in Europe from early 2000s until 2015. So he denies any involvement with amateur radio or tabletop role-playing games. Philip is also a director of the FreeBSD Foundation. So before we begin, just a quick show of hands. Anybody here running a FreeBSD? Two?
More
open. A bit more than two.
And anybody using some form of BSD?
So am I correct to say that Mac is based on BSD, or am I
yes.
wrong?
Well, yes, it's a BSD derivative.
So maybe we got more than that?
Yes. It's everywhere. If you have a toaster, it probably runs that BSD. thank you, everyone. Thank you for the introduction. There's a lot of Linux at this conference, and that's very nice. But I'm here to tell you that you don't have to live like this. there is another way. I won't necessarily say it's a better way, but there's another way. So one of the things that Linux has is Linux has this distribution system where you gather a lot of bits, you take a Linux kernel, you take all sorts of other bits of bobs and dusts, you pile it together, and you call it a distribution, you install it, and you hope for the best. And there's all this fragmentation going on. So FreeBSD does not work this way. We are not a Linux distribution. For one thing, we don't use Linux. But we're also a different kind of distribution. So I can probably skip this slide since our dear moderator has read this out to us. But as I go through this talk, bear in mind that I'm a kernel hacker. I care deeply about my kernel, my operating system. I like it to crash while I'm developing it, and I don't want it to crash after I'm done developing it. And when it crashes, I want to know why. I'm also a consultant. My customers give me money by the hour, so they want me to stop working as soon as possible. So I care about efficiency. I teach things, so I care about things being readable and obvious in source code. And I'm giving this talk as a director of the FreeBSD Foundation, which is a charity entity that provides somewhere for the FreeBSD Foundation to go. I also am a conference organizer, repeat offender. I have organized many conferences over the years, and I just can't say no to organizing conferences. That's all very boring. Let me talk about FreeBSD. FreeBSD is a complete operating system. So in the Linux world, the operating system is defined as the kernel, which is a whole bunch of source code which you download from kernel.org, or most people don't download from kernel.org, and you put it together with a C library, you put it together with a graphics stack, and all sorts of other stuff, and you call that a distribution. In FreeBSD, we call this the operating system. We don't distinguish between the kernel and the C library. They're not different projects, they are just part of the operating system. So the same people who write your kernel, your system calls, actually implement the use of the system calls in the C library. We provide tools and source codes, so we're a completely open source operating system. We provide you the kernel and the tools to use it. So we'll see that later. If you install FreeBSD, you get all the tools you need to start coding. We also have a ports collection or a package collection, which at the time this presentation was written, had 24,000 open source packages in it. So you install FreeBSD, and then for some reason you like a world of pain and you use Emacs. So you feel you need Emacs, so you package install Emacs, and you can suffer in silence. We also provide complete documentation of the system, which if you're familiar with Linux, this might seem surprising to you. We document our entire operating system, and we consider it to be a bug if something is not documented. We consider documentation to be a first-class citizen, and we translate it into many languages. We are also a vibrant open source community. I don't remember how many committers we have, a couple of hundreds working on different things. We organize conferences in different parts of the world, and we like eating tasty things in warm and nice countries. So we are a community producing an operating system. So who have we convinced to use this stuff? Well, everyone, it turns out. This is just a selection of companies which admits to using FreeBSD. As we'll see later, you don't have to tell us that you're using it because our license is just, you know, here's our software, go and use it. But these companies have admitted to using FreeBSD. Apple is very well known for using BSD. The Mac OS X is basically the FreeBSD kernel merged with the Mach scheduler and a whole lot of Apple secret sauce. And, you know, about 20 years of developer time times X developers, and it turns into Mac OS X. It also runs on the iPhone, of course. WhatsApp is a fairly popular messaging application. They run FreeBSD on all of their servers, and admit to doing so. Sony, of course, runs FreeBSD on their PlayStation, I think. There are also, I think the rumors have been confirmed, that Nintendo now runs it on the Switch. And a whole bunch of other companies just use FreeBSD, and they just, they are happy.
You used to run the Xbox as well.
The Xbox presumably also runs, so it's everywhere. Yahoo runs FreeBSD on Yahoo Mail, so quite a lot of the spam on the internet is actually going through FreeBSD. But why do these people use FreeBSD? Well, they use it for a number of reasons, not just because we're nice people and we're fun to hang out with, but they also like the fact that we have a strong culture of innovation in our community. We look at technology out there, we grab the best bits, we learn from other projects, and we innovate slowly, we pull things in. We also have great tools. So FreeBSD, when you install our software, you get a whole set of tools that are fun to work with and just work for you. We have a mature release model. We don't just throw software over the wall when we're done with it. We have a release process, we have branches, and we have to use a corporate term, we have a product life cycle that goes into this. And I can't stress this enough, we have excellent documentation in many languages, including Chinese and other Asian languages. Japanese is a very thorough translation. FreeBSD Handbook, this is a point Chinese version, which I think is one of our most complete translations. We have a very business-friendly license, so companies like Apple don't like the, well, companies might like it, but the legal departments of these companies do not like having a license which is 4,000 pages long and filled with restrictions on what you can and cannot do. FreeBSD Project has a much simpler license, which I'll highlight in a couple of slides, which is, you know, you take our software and you enjoy it. And our community is very open. It's very easy to join the FreeBSD community. Many companies find it easy to subscribe to our mailing lists, and suddenly they have employees committing code to the FreeBSD tree. I mentioned our documentation, the FreeBSD Handbook. This is the Chinese version of the FreeBSD Handbook. It is actually real. We admit to it existing, and it can tell you everything. So how did we get here? The history of Linux, I think, is very widely known. The history of BSD is quite a bit longer, and I have 3 minutes to talk about this. So once upon a time, in the Dark Ages, chaos reigned. We had no operating systems. We were happy then. We lived in caves. We made grunting noises. We hit each other with clubs, and it was so much more fun. Then, once upon a time, in the 60s, we had Nautix, some nice people. I think Stanford perpetrated most of that and some other universities. They came up with, you know, we can have these computers and they can talk to each other, and that was fun. Then Unix came up in Bell Labs, the other side of the country, and that was fun. You know, this runs on our PDP-11. This is fun. We can have multiple users, we can run software on it, and this is great fun. But wouldn't it be nice if these computers could talk to each other? So we had the CSRG grant, you know, write us a network stack, or write us stuff, and that was all BSD code written. So we had Berkeley tapes, we came up with VI, BSD projects came up with VI. If you're using VI, that's our fault. We had a Pascal compiler, and it just goes on to the history of computing is actually the history of BSD, right? So all of these things, from chaos to the AT&T lawsuits to BSD being free is essentially the history of operating systems in Unix. So who was alive when chaos reigned? I wasn't. Who was alive during the BSD and AT&T lawsuits? Early 90s? Most people were. So we have a long history of writing code. Throughout this whole Unix process, we thought about things and just did things. So let's talk about BSD specifically. I'm with the FreeBSD Foundation, but there are actually other BSD operating systems. macOS X is a hybrid sort of operating system. But when we think about BSD, we think about four main BSD operating systems. NetBSD was the first BSD operating system. They focus mainly on portability. So they want to run on your toaster, they want to run on your printer. And they do indeed. I don't know how many printers are out there running NetBSD, but many, many printers run NetBSD. FreeBSD feels very strongly about performance. So the original intent of the FreeBSD project was to be the best BSD on i386. We are now the best BSD on any printer, of course. The OpenBSD project focuses mostly on security. They branched off from NetBSD in 1996 because they felt security was more important than platforms. So OpenBSD is very popular in the wonderful world of firewalls and security. And then our most recent BSD project is PCBSD. It's now called TrueOS. It's actually a fork of FreeBSD, and not really a fork in the way you know it in the Linux community, but it's a derivative. So they take FreeBSD and they follow us very closely, and they add all of the graphical bits which you want on your laptop. So if you want to, or in a virtual machine where you want to be a developer, you install PCBSD and you get a FreeBSD kernel and all of the tools you need to be productive, in addition to just a compiler, a shell, and VI. They also make it very easy to upgrade your machine. They use ZFS, which I'll talk about later, and jails to make upgrades very seamless. And if they blow up, then you know you could easily revert your snapshots and go back to your known working state in about 10 seconds time without having to grab your backup tapes, which you then remember you didn't. So all of our BSD projects believe in producing a whole system. So the operating system I mentioned is everything, the kernel plus everything around it, its device drivers, its compilers and associated tools, also debugging tools, we'll get to debugging in a moment, and editors. So the point of this whole BSD thing is you install it and you are ready to code. Whether you are a user space application developer or you are a kernel developer, you install the operating system and you can type vi mumble.c and you can be productive. And then you can cc mumble.c and it will work, hopefully. This is different from the Linux world where you install your operating system and then you need to go and download all the packages in the world. And then you find someone else's computer and they have different packages. So what's in this whole system of ours? So we said the operating system. Well, what's in the operating system? We have some file systems. We have the traditional Unix file system, UFS, which is your grandfather's file system. Yeah, it's high performance for some values of performance. It supports snapshots, so you can go back in time, copy on write without too much difficulty. And we have journaled soft updates now, so if your machine crashes in the middle of a write, your file system is not hosed. We also support ZFS, which is the file system to end all file systems. It's also a volume manager and a RAID implementation. And FreeBSD is probably the reference implementation of ZFS. I think Illumos is the actual reference implementation, but FreeBSD is certainly the most used implementation of ZFS. If you care about your data, you really want to put it in ZFS. ZFS acknowledges that disks are really the enemy, and they lie to you, and they try to eat your data. And ZFS tries to protect you from your disks. You store your disks, you store your data in ZFS, and you can be confident that you can get it out later. It checksums in the background, and it's all sorts of goodness.
So how did the Sun community license get mixed up with BSD?
It's a different license, right? Yes, so ZFS is under a CDDL, but that's fine. We don't care. It's an open source license. You can use it.
BSD license, or?
No, ZFS is CDDL, it's the community mumble license. But it's perfectly compatible with BSD because it's open source. Anything open source is compatible with the BSD license. It's very nice. So I think there's a ZFS port to Linux as well, but it will never make it to the kernel for non-technical reasons. We also have security features in FreeBSD. It's not just because the OpenBSD people focus on security that FreeBSD has no security. We do actually care deeply about security as well. We came up with the concept of jails roughly at the same time as the Sun people came up with containers. Our jail framework in FreeBSD is a way to restrict routes to a little bit more than the file system. So it allows you to create a kind of chroot with an IP address and lock processes up in that. It's different from Linux namespaces because it's actually a system call, and you create a jail and you're ready to go, whereas with Linux you need to add a namespace and then you have a C group, and then you have a process namespace, you have 16 different namespaces, and to containerize anything in Linux is a pain. We also have the Mac and audit framework, so if you live in an environment where you need to audit your system and your users, who did what to whom and where, and well, you can't answer why because we don't work that way. But if you want to know who touched the file last, we can audit this. We have a distributed audit mechanism, which uses the same format as the Solaris, so you can audit off-site easily, so no one can tamper with your audit records. If you're just logging to a file, touch the file, and your audit log is gone, our audit framework sends your audit log to another machine, which hopefully is secure. And that's out of the box on FreeBSD, you don't need to install it. We also have something called Capsicum, which is a capability system for Unix, where you can declare in your application that it should have minimal privilege on a function level. So you say, okay, from this point on, my application should no longer be able to write to any files. So you restrict your privilege, and you can never expand your privileges again. Once you have entered a capability sandbox, you cannot break out of it. So this is used in our TCP dump and our gzip library. So once you start TCP dumping on an interface, the dissectors run in their own little sandbox, and nobody can send nasty packets on the wire, which then go and write files to your file system and break things. Or if you're uncompressing a file, if the compressed data happens to be nasty, you're in a sandbox, it can't break out. So we have this in FreeBSD. I don't think it exists in any other system yet. We also have innovative compiler technology. In the previous talk, we had a brief digression on LLVM. FreeBSD uses LLVM and Clang as our system compiler on all platforms and support it, so you don't have to suffer GCC. LLVM is an extensible compiler with a static analyzer like Kili. You can run static analysis on the FreeBSD kernel. I think you can also run FoxML on the FreeBSD kernel. People probably have done it. But LLVM also knows about C, and if you've got LLVM, why would you go and use something on top of it? We are in the process of replacing our linker. Has anyone in this room ever fought with GNU-LD? Written a linker script? Did you enjoy the experience?
No.
Right, so if you've ever touched linkers if GNU-LD debugging in GNU-LD is a fun process. We have LLD now, and it is much better. Life is much better. Writing linker scripts is still no fun, but at least a space in the wrong place will not crash your linker. We also have LLDB now, so we still support GDB, but LLDB is a much more accessible debugger. So GDB now has support for Python scripts. LLDB has a much more. LLDB was written with accessibility in mind. It's also it also builds on LLVM, so it has a lot more context about your code from the beginning. So we support LLDB on, I think, Intel and AMD 64, not yet on ARM, but I think that's work in progress. So this moves compilers into the 21st century. It's just a much better world than GDB. So that's the compile side of things. We also support dtrace, and as a kernel developer, I cannot remember what life was like before dtrace. I have purged the experiences from my life. Dtrace has been an epiphany for me. Dtrace provides complete system transparency. Anything that is happening on your system, dtrace can tell you. It can show you when you are entering a function, when you are leaving a function, what this function is doing, and until you enable a probe, it is it's not there. So it's designed to run in production, and it works really well. We have dtrace inside the kernel. We also have dtrace, user space dtrace now. It's still a little bit hairy here and there, but it works quite well. So dtrace, if you are a kernel developer, you should really enjoy dtrace. We also have a network stack, obviously. The BSDs were the reference implementation of the internet, and we still are. We have pluggable TCP stacks. The BBR stack is working in FreeBSD for people who like that. The rack stack, Cubic, and Urino is the default. We have any number of firewalls. Last count, we had two, possibly three. And we have WNet as a packet shaper. We have NetMap for people who like user space network stacks and putting things into queues and doing all sorts of low latency fun things. We have Eel, we have VXLAN. If you are a networking sort of person, BSD is fun to work on. The BSD network stack is also mostly readable and fun to hack on. I'm almost running out of time. The virtualization, we support virtualization, obviously. We have a hypervisor called Beehive. It is ready to run any operating system you can think of, and it's been ported to macOS. So if you have a Mac, you can use xHive, and it supports the same command line options as on FreeBSD. Our release process also gives you, in addition to DVDs, floppy images for those who want them, netboot images, etc. We also have VMware images, QMU images, etc. We also have Amazon images produced by the release engineering team, so you can just spin up an Amazon box with a FreeBSD image, and that will be supported by the FreeBSD community and updates that we also expect. Our hypervisor, of course, is BSD licensed, so you can port it to any platform you like. We have more features. We scaled many, many cores. We have NUA support, so non-uniform memory addresses. We run on ARM64. I think currently we have a limitation of 96 cores. Anything more than that, life gets a bit interesting on ARM. That should be broken soon enough. We support multipath TCP as well, for people who like that sort of thing. And we, I added this just at the last minute, if you are on a modern server which needs UEFI, you can boot FreeBSD from a secure boot and UEFI environment without too much difficulty. It just works. I'm almost out of time. So any questions so far? Do I have 5 more minutes? Or 3 more minutes? I lost track of time. I have 5 more minutes? Okay, good, excellent. Not running out of time too far. So I mentioned all of these technical things, and everyone is now obviously installing FreeBSD on their virtual machine. Amazon machines run up, you're running FreeBSD update, and life is good. While you are doing that, let me tell you about how the project works. I mentioned the vibrant community with conferences everywhere. We have a democratically elected core team. We have no dictator. There is no one in the FreeBSD project who says, this patch, we don't like this patch, or we don't like the person who wrote this patch. We don't have that in the FreeBSD project. We are friendly people. We have a core team, which is elected every few years among the developers. Satosan, in the back of the room there, has been on the core team for a long time. I have been a secretary, but I have been relieved of my duties. We have a concept of mentorship, which if you've ever participated in the Google Summer of Code project, they stole that from us. So we've had mentorship since the early 90s, where basically you submit patches to us, and then we notice that you're submitting all these patches, and we say, you're submitting all these very good patches. How would you like to, commit your own patches, and I don't have to do it. So we invite people to join our community based on their track record, on their work. If you do good work, we will invite you to become a committer, and we will mentor you through this process until we think you are ready to roam on your own. We have lots of hats where, if you are doing security work, you will wear a security hat. If you are doing release work, you wear a release hat. But we have no dictator. So the hats are more by, you want to do this, okay, you go and do this. And it all works very democratically and in a friendly way. So how do you become a committer? Now that you have all installed FreeBSD on your Amazon machines, you have now found your first bug. Excellent. How do you join our community? Well, you complain about this bug. Where do you complain about the bug? Well, you complain about the bug on our mailing list. So you join the mailing list and you discover that these are friendly mailing lists. You check out the code. We use Subversion because we believe in version control, but we also support the Git collaboration system for people who are into that, and we have a mirror on GitHub. Once you have fixed your bug, you submit it to our review system, and after you submit any number of patches, people will get bored of reviewing your patches, and someone will offer to mentor you into your process. After you know a couple of emails back and forth, you will be proposed for a commitment to the core team. The core team will say, oh yes, yes, why isn't she a committer already? She's been sending so many patches. So you get a commitment, which allows you to type SVM commits, and the patch enters our tree. And a script will check that you have a review line. So we insist on getting code reviewed before it enters the tree. That catches a lot of bugs. After a while, you've not broken the build for a couple of weeks, your mentor will say, okay, go forth and do more damage. At that point, you go, you're in the review system and you get bored of someone's patches, so you make them a mentee and the process just repeats itself. So this has happened, for hundreds of people, and we have so that's our community. We also have a license. I promise to do that. This is the BSD license. People can recite it from memory. I'm not going to do that. This is our entire license. Here is our software. Go forth and use it. Don't blame us if it breaks. And it would be nice if you acknowledged that we wrote it. This is the GPL. Yes. Two of the GPL, V3 of the GPL does not fit in slide. BSD license is 226 words. It is very open, very permissive, not restrictive and not viral. GPL V2 is 2,968 words. It restricts what you can do with your own code in addition to what other people can do with it, and it is viral with open access. If you would like to learn more about FreeBSD, you should find our website. We have a website. We have a foundation, the FreeBSD Foundation. I'm a director of the foundation, so I set this up. If you have too much money and you are using FreeBSD to make this money, we will gladly relieve you of this burden and ensure that FreeBSD is improved in the process. We have a GitHub project, we have some mailing lists, forums, handbook, and IRC. And I think that puts me officially out of time. Any questions?
No. They have their drivers, right? Who writes them for BSD or BSD or BSD?
I do. Well, I don't write all of them, but many people write device drivers.
Because in the enterprise world, they are usually written by the device manufacturers.
Yes. So,
how does it work for BSD?
Many vendors of popular hardware write BSD drivers. So we have Intel device drivers, which are maintained by Intel employees and blessed. I think the network device driver team at Intel uses a common source tree for many of their devices between various operating systems, so they are maintained by them. Silver Flare paid me money to write a device driver for them. Chelsea, someone writes device drivers for them. So it works much the same way as it works on Linux. People write device drivers and people commit them.
So you're saying on enterprise servers, all this, right?
Yes.
The hardware would usually work because manufacturers commit directly to the kernel?
Yes, or they hire consultants to write their device drivers. But remember our mentorship process. So what happens is, you hire consultants for a couple of weeks or months to write your device driver. And usually this person will work with your team. And then, after you're done paying this expensive consultant, you maintain it yourself. And as part of our mentorship process, you usually just become a committer after a while. So that's how we ended up with committers at Intel, how we ended up with committers at many of the storage companies. They just, they started with a device driver and then they just somehow got assimilated into our community. They show up to our conferences, not just for the food, but also because, interesting content. So yes, we have device drivers. Usually our device drivers, it takes a bit longer for exotic hardware to become supported in FreeBSD, but if it's actually viable hardware, it does become supported in due course. Graphics is the one that usually takes very long because nobody needs to write graphics drivers. We have a very good sound stack here. Yes?
I'm just curious about the mailing list.
Yes.
I haven't worked on FreeBSD ever, so I'm just curious if people are scared of the FreeBSD mailing list just like the Linux kind of mailing list?
Not at all. Actually, you say this. I was teaching a course a while ago in Chennai for a vendor of lots of hardware. And I had a group of people in the room who had written many Linux device drivers, and they mentioned, you know, we subscribed to the FreeBSD mailing list and we submitted patches and we were not shouted at. And they were very confused about this concept. You know, you join the FreeBSD hackers or the FreeBSD current mailing list, and nobody shouts at you. It's, I have reviewed your patch and I found, you know, this problem. You know, fix this. Wow, I wasn't shouted at. That's wonderful. So if you're familiar with the Linux kernel mailing list, which is a slightly hostile environment, you will find the FreeBSD mailing list is a lot more friendly. We have cranky people as well. I'm a cranky person. But we usually try to complain about the software rather than the people who write it, which I think is a much better strategy for success. And you know, even if we complain about the software, we try to complain in politely. Never write email before the second cup of coffee. Any more questions? Yes?
So do you have like maintainer subsystem?
Yes, we have a file at the top level of the source tree, which is the most maintained file in the source tree. it is called maintainers and it is perpetually out of date. But we have, basically we operate under a principle that, you know, don't pee in someone else's pond. If you're going to touch a file, we have revision control, so it's usually customary that you go and, you know, send an email to whoever touched that file, or you post to the mailing list and you just CC whoever touched the file last. Some subsystems have a little bit more ownership than others, but it usually becomes immediately obvious. So if you're going to touch, say, the PAM stack, or you're going to touch the audit framework, it's usually immediately obvious that those parts of the kernel have clear concepts of ownership. But you know, you submit a patch to the mailing list or to the review system, it will be immediately picked up.
Yeah, no. So I mean, if someone like he asked, if someone has hired a consultant, they wrote the driver and they just went to other work. So if they are not maintaining that driver, then who is maintaining?
We try not to break software that works. So we don't, we don't.
So
try not to.
Is it like maintained for the all versions, like stable versions?
Yes. Okay, I see what you're asking. So the Linux kernel has a very fast moving target and has a mentality of code first, think later. So, you know, you develop, I've been brutally honest here. You develop a framework and then 2 weeks later someone changes their mind and all the device drivers need to be rewritten, well, not from scratch, but vast swathes of code need to be rewritten. In FreeBSD, we don't really have this. We try to have mostly stable interfaces, and this works for us. So, also, if you are going to break an interface, it is on you to make sure that nothing else breaks. So nobody touches struct netif, because I don't want to touch all the device drivers. So if you are going to do massive changes in the kernel, you are expected to make sure that there is no fallout. But most parts of the FreeBSD kernel are actually reasonably well maintained. And we try to mothball things that have no clear use. So we're getting rid of one of our ATM stacks now. Nobody uses ATM anymore, so that code is now dying. As far as we know, it still works, but nobody wants it, so we're getting rid of it. Any more questions? Has anyone panicked their fresh FreeBSD Amazon instance? Alright, so join the FreeBSD community, there is a better way of life. if you like Oxygenel though, I'm sure it works, we should chat. I like it. Thank you very much.